Welcome to the 10th lecture of the spring 2016 Baumer Lecture Series at the Knowlton School. My name is Andrew Cruz. I'm an assistant professor of architecture and chair of this year's series. Before introducing tonight's lecturer, Geoffrey von Oeyen, I have two announcements. First, the landscape symposium. This is a test. We'll start on Friday the 1st, that's this Friday, and run through Saturday the 2nd. Friday's events will be held at the Wexner Center, starting at 9 a.m. with a keynote speech by Georges de Combes, a Swiss landscape architect. Admission is free, but registration is required. So go to the KSA website and register for the symposium. The second announcement is that following the symposium on Saturday, April the 2nd, is the Beaux-Arts Ball, organized by the AAAS. It's going to be held at the Center for Architecture and Design in downtown Columbus from 8 to 11 on Saturday. For those of you without a car, there'll be a shuttle running between campus and the center, and there will be tickets on sale after the lecture tonight out by the gallery. So get your tickets. They're $5 tonight and will be $10 at the door. So tonight's speaker, Geoffrey von Oeyen, is an architect in Los Angeles, an assistant professor of practice at the University of Southern California, and a sailor. What initially drew me to Geoffrey and his work was the combined interest in architecture and in sailing. Specifically, a show he did at USC in 2014 called Performative Composites, Sailing Architecture. Through their synthesis of advanced materials, sophisticated workflows of digital and manual fabrication, and elegant forms responsive to hydrodynamic and aerodynamic forces, as well as the hand of the designer, today's high-performance sailboat offers a paradigm for contemporary architecture. They're model combinations of design and performance, and indeed, performance takes a front role. As an example, during the 160-year history of the America's Cup race, it took about 100 years for boats to go from 10 miles an hour to about 13 miles an hour. Well, in the last 15 years, the speed has increased fourfold to almost 60 miles an hour. Riding on hydrofoils with rigid sails, the boats can now sail faster than the wind. These are no Bodie McBoat faces. While architecture struggles today with issues of carbon and energy, such boats offer an example of high design and zero energy to which architecture can aspire. Although the relationship between boat building, or better yet, naval architecture, and a land-based architecture may seem a stretch, there's a long history of a shared interest between these aqueous and terrestrial environments. During the Renaissance, Alberti discussed ship materials and design in his On the Art of Building. During the Enlightenment, Blondel's entry of architecture in Diderot's Encyclopedia addressed both civil and naval architecture. And in the 20th century, Norman Bel Geddes and Pierre Partou developed a streamlined style of Art Deco that's seen in the formal, spatial, and material expression of both boats and buildings. To this mix, Le Corbusier's Toward a New Architecture took the cruise ship as a model of efficiency and function and the subject of some of his more memorable collages. More recently, architects as diverse as Renzo Piano, who's built no fewer than 6 boats, and Greg Lynn, who's built 1, continue this trajectory. Well, true to his surname, Piano tends to play down the connection between boats and buildings in a way that is more pianissimo. Greg Lynn's approach is dynamically opposite. Beginning with the book Animate Form, he has recently designed and built his own boat, a sailing trimaran, which he regularly discusses as a source of inspiration and experimentation within his body of work. Well, in Ohio, we may be far from the ocean. The development of composite materials from which today's boats are built had their origin, and today's boats were built in, which were the subject of Geoffrey's show, had their origin here at OSU. Ray Green was a 1932 graduate of the OSU College of Engineering, where he did a thesis on fiberglass boat hull construction. Working with Owens Corning in Toledo, he built the world's first fiberglass sailboat in 1942. And it's through the joint axes of materials and fabrication that boats may have the most direct relationship to architectural design today. A prime example of this would be the fabricator Chrysler Associates that began by fabricating boat hulls and now makes building elements, including the facade of Snohetta's extension to the San Francisco MoMA, as well as the plasticity pavilion built by our own Justin Dials. Well, the theme of materials, form, and fabrication are the strongest parallels between boats and buildings. Geoffrey's own biography offers another. Trained at Stanford University, the University of Cambridge, and Harvard's GSD, Geoffrey was an associate at Gehry Partners, where he worked on, among other projects, the Louis Vuitton Foundation in Paris. He was also the team captain of the office sailboat, Foggy. Since founding his own design studio in 2012, he's been awarded the Architectural League Prize from the Architectural League of New York, and is at work on a number of projects which merge these interests in boats and in buildings. We look forward to hearing more about them this evening. Please join me in welcoming Geoffrey von Oeyen.
Thank you. That's great. Thank you so much. Okay, can you guys hear me okay? All right. Andrew, thank you so much. Very, very kind introduction, and thank you for having me here and allowing me to share my work with you guys. What a beautiful architecture building and place to study architecture, my gosh. I've seen a lot of schools. This is great. It's a nice place to be. I titled this evening's talk of sight, and sailing. And as Andrew mentioned, some of the topics that interest me are explicitly, let's say formally or in some way or another, related to sailing in ways that you could easily identify. Other parts of them are analogies that I've been drawing in my work about sight, about the relationship of a building or a place in a landscape or a city, and about view and calibration and optics. So for me, the process of sailing is actually an optical process. It's done optically. You're looking at the shape of sails and you're trimming them according to the form that's most related to the point of sail and the wind direction. And then sailing, I'll talk about explicitly in some of the, I'm going to share the exhibition that Andrew had mentioned. Because this is a talk to primarily students, I wanted to share briefly a little bit about my academic formation. When I was a student at Stanford, I did my thesis on Le Corbusier's capital complex at Chandigarh, and took these slides when people still took slides of the capital. And it's something like a series of boats in the landscape. And it's something like Le Corbusier talked about these as islands. He sketched them as islands and how they dealt with the horizon and how they actually registered natural conditions. This is a model from the office, and these are some of the projects in the Capitol, some of the solar monuments that he used to actually register a sun and shadow. And the thesis that I wrote for my MPhil dissertation at Cambridge right after was on a particular project there, which is the Museum of Knowledge. And this particular vessel had a lot of projective and optical features in the presentation of information. And it's something that stuck with me as I started doing architecture. Fast forward a few years, when I was a student, as many of you are as a graduate student, Michael Meredith was teaching at Harvard in his first term, and Toshiko Mori paired the two of us. I was finishing, it was my last year, paired us to work with Pierre Huig, the artist, to do a puppet theater. And it was 500 polycarbonate panels, and it's underneath of the Carpenter Center in Cambridge, which is the only building in North America by Le Corbusier. So it was a perfect pairing for me to get to relate to my historical work to Le Corbusier with contemporary fabrication and work with a really wonderful artist. Drawing of the panel assembly for that. This was a milky white polycarbonate that was manufactured by someone out of Birmingham, Alabama, who typically does, you know, slush puppy machines and hunting sheds and that sort of thing. So it was an unusual process to try to make something that was for architecture through a process that was typically not for architecture. And I'd say in this view as well, something about the sight part of it, or the optical part of it, how this was a proscenium for the puppet show, and the other direction was a particular framed view of a tree and out to nature in Harvard Yard. And that's something that I think was really formative, and I wanted to share that. Right after I did that, I worked on my thesis, as some of you have done or are doing right now, my master's thesis, which was on Lafayette Park in Detroit. And when I was a kid, I lived here briefly before moving to California. I was born in Detroit, so I have a little bit of a lot of Midwesterner in me. This was a great opportunity to revisit a place that I knew as a child, but was able to study from the similar perspective as the Le Corbusier work, as a project that was unbuilt. Most of it was built. Most of it got built, but these plots here did not get built. And some not so nice stuff got built in their place in the Mies and Hilbersheimer plan. And I became interested in nature, the relationship between the organic and the inorganic, and the idea of a constructed nature. It was natural for certain systematic reasons as opposed to mimetic reasons. And then looking at kind of a formal analysis of the Mies housing typologies, became very interested in how the landscape and the views were actually divided optically. There's great work on this. There's several great essays on this. I started looking at the unit types, unit typology, and started thinking about how units might be aggregated in ways that they overlapped in particular volumetric procedures that Mies had used, and then thought about folding the landscape in a particular way. And instead of having these straight walls that create the particular symmetries that Robin Evans writes about, for instance, I played these out in particular ways to figure space, and then kind of my first foray into CATIA and digital project, you know, was looking at how to assemble these pieces and build these particular walls that performed a multiplicity of things. And I think here, you know, as a sailor, since I was very little, actually in Detroit, and then I sailed for Stanford University and the varsity team, and I was thinking about ways that form and performance were related, and were seeking ways to leverage everything I could out of the particular formal moves, whether it was circulation and light and structure, ventilation. I became interested in the sort of constructed reality of the kind of Miesian modern relationship to the original street grid that was in Detroit before the site was cleared and redone, and then another kind of system of these more natural, so to speak, erosion patterns or something running through the site, which became public amenities and circulation spaces. And so the project became about light gauge steel construction in this case, and about how these sticks could aggregate, and how private and public spaces were mediated through these particular walls, spatially, visually. And this is one of the blocks. I'm going to go quite quickly through some of this stuff because I have a lot. I have a lot to cover. And some of the views of the interiors, the types of spaces you'd get in this kind of multi-layer condition where you would park underneath through the central spine, and you'd have a landscaped walk in the back in park space, and sort of a private courtyard between the public and private spaces. Some of the public amenities, structural systems, models, surface models. Stairs, shelving, what the landscape condition would be like in relation to the contextual relationship these would have to the kind of Mesian elevations. So, as Andrew mentioned, immediately after GSD, I worked at Gary Partners. I was an associate there for 6 years, 7 years. I've worked on about a dozen projects, including this one. Talking about the experience here would be a whole other talk. It's an amazing place to work. I learned a huge amount. The project that I spent about 4 years on was the Fondation Louis Vuitton from the beginning in 2005. I was actually hired to start on this project as it was in concept design, and then saw this through. And interestingly enough for me, one of the images and a point of interest in the office was about sailing, something that Frank was interested in because he's an avid sailor and just designed a boat. And he had actually, that's me, had asked me to help him to pick out a boat, and he was extraordinarily gracious and let us race it on Wednesday nights. So we had a sailing team in the office. So it was about a crew of about 8 people. I was a helmsman. There's LA, really just magical experience as a young person, you know, learning about architecture and doing this project simultaneously. And Frank's interest in sailing with his design partner Edwin Chan and later Craig Webb working on the shape of these sails and the icebergs within and the gallery spaces. That's the built, and the work, the digital modeling in digital project and physical model, working them together with the drawings, that kind of tripartite of drawings and physical model and BIM digital model was kind of always cycling in the office. So again, the physical model, digital model, drawing. Lots of surface analysis for the glass shapes, and a huge exercise, enormous technical exercise that the office underwent with a number of highly regarded engineering and geometry consultants, including Gary Technologies. The iceberg system, the skin, it's fiber-reinforced concrete panel system that I worked to rationalize and design and pattern. And again, the surface analysis for that. And the idea of these forms and quite sculptural in nature, looking at how they would perform and circulation would happen in relation to them, or light would be modulated in some particular way. Very exciting project to work on. As Andrew mentioned, I had the privilege of participating in the Young Architects Prize and an exhibition in New York in 2014. And between Gary Partners and this point, I did a number of projects starting my practice. This is the book. And what had happened in this was I had become, just through the necessity of not working on the Fondation Louis Vuitton, but doing small residential projects and doing everything that you do when you start out, you end up doing work that's very economical, and you end up dealing with all sorts of bizarre site conditions, additions, whatever you're given. And I think one of the comments that was made in the forward to this book by Preston Scott Cohen that I really liked, that I was just super excited when I saw it, was that he had talked about how I was looking for new possibilities within the intractable givens, turning otherwise functionally necessary forms into optical devices that induce spatial experiences. And for me, there was something important about that, and maybe back to the theme of sailing, that it was taking these given conditions and leveraging them in some way. That I wasn't operating in a vacuum, that I was doing something that was using the environment around the project itself. This was the exhibition of the work at the Architectural League. And I tried to use the opportunity to present the work as a way that represented my design ambitions and ideas, and that I was given this site, which was a gallery, white wall, white box gallery, ubiquitous in the way that art is presented in our culture, and took that on and made a perfect golden rectangle metafigure, and then situated all the projects and organized them within that, and kind of had them all oriented toward the center for viewing. So they all, it's a concave shape, but they all kind of are tweaked and maneuvered to reflect the light a little bit differently and to organize themselves in their project group. These were the projects that I presented for that. These were mostly residential, and all the projects were designed with the intent of being built. You get a sense for the concave and the way that I wanted the surfaces of the installation to actually reflect the light coming in the window from Fifth Avenue at Parsons. You get a sense here, looking dead on, the concavity of this with the pieces facing you, series of drawings and models, and then how it registered the light at the different times of day, made you more aware of the light in the gallery and the shadows that it cast, and made you aware of what was going on outside through the reflections, kind of this yellow taxi cab, bouncing off there. And then this idea of reflection, again, looking at how from the exterior the reflections of the city were projected onto the piece and projected outward, so that it sort of projected itself into the city. in a sort of gridded way, like a window, series of window bays beyond. And use these little canyons, these sort of slot canyons, to organize the pieces. And while this was maybe a still frame in an animate bas relief, the slot canyons were a slower erosion or a slower pattern of movement through the piece. So that it had a temporal dimension. I'm going to go through these pretty quickly, but this was a project for a pavilion. And it was a device that was really intended to register light and shadow through folds of geometry through the surface, intended to reveal a really broad range of tones and forms through shadow, reflection, light, different shadow configurations, registering very different figures in the ground. And that ended up not being realized. I did, however, start this project. This was started pretty early on, which was an addition for some attorneys in Malibu. And it's a new workspace for them. They have a very successful law practice dealing with very high-profile clients, and they needed a place where they could meet that would augment their downtown Los Angeles location. And I started looking at ways that through the geometry of the site and the existing house that was there, inscribe this particular project into the site, and then use the roof planes to modulate the light in particular ways so that there would be an even north light that would come through and move across the space over the course of the day. And then designed a series of views out of the space into the surrounding garden and adjacent house, and tried to make this addition renovation to just calibrate this so precisely to its site in every way that I could, and thereby revealing something new or different about the site that wasn't known before. It's a view to the north, and a series of roof planes that were designed to bounce light back from the south to the north and illuminate various walls. You can see this clear story effect. And some construction photos in progress. But I really want these lines to be, you know, very clear, clearly inscribed in the form itself. The contractors actually refer to this roof as sails. This is actually a contract. The contractor who's building it is a sailor. And it's kind of, the framing is actually a little bit like a spinnaker pattern by which the joists come together at various ridges and distribute the load. And again, some of this framing and sectional quality of these particular clear story spaces, and um, Another project I started early on was this pool house in Malibu, which was built into the hillside and again was designed as an optical device, cut away from a hillside to have these views to the ocean and to bring light down into the ground in a particular way. And there was a sequence associated with that. And you had a particular view and maybe a doubling of that view in the reflection. This project fell through for permitting reasons, but this project is going ahead, which has many of its qualities. It's an old ranch house from the 60s in Malibu that's right over the ocean. It has like 180 degree view of the Pacific Ocean from this Palos Verdes up to the Channel Islands. And the problem with the house as it exists is that in the existing footprint, all the back of house stuff is here. So this is like some kitchen and storage and such when this is the primary view to the ocean. And so in this addition renovation, this is basically chamfered and the two grids are reconciled through this addition with the pool providing that. And when you come down the driveway, you register the horizon, call this the horizon house. Here are the various axes. This is where the existing roof is bifurcated and split, raised upward. And this is the interior condition that produces, where you keep the existing ranch house roof, but you actually demolish it and reconstruct it. It's going to look the same from the exterior, but now with the steel construction, that you can remove the ceiling and you can have that tilted roof plane and you can just lift this, and then this is about a 57 foot long span that allows for this opening, which matches the same dimension as the pool. And then studying the light conditions in here, what is experienced in terms of light. So the huge emphasis I've placed on registering natural light and trying to identify what conditions are optimal at different times of year and then design the house accordingly. These shades on the deck are retractable awnings like a sail. So these are, you trim them to the appropriate light condition. So when you want to block light and then refract light up to the clear story, you use these elements. And everything is pointed again to the horizon on the house and kind of levels out and points outward. Some sections. And this is the plan. You can see the grid, kind of reconciliation of the two halves of the house through this new concrete floor and deck that's scored. This is a house in Marfa, Texas. This is the site, again looking out into the landscape, studying the site conditions and the orientation of the house in relation to the views to distant mountains and the neighbors, and again trying to inscribe this house as a particular vessel in the site. And a parametric study of the different courtyard conditions that the house massing could create. different driveway types. The approach to the house and the different elevations as it reveals itself as an object. Again, daylighting studies. Physical models, little 3D printed models compared with light renderings and daylight analysis. And this kind of oddly tilted roof that comes out of a relationship with the hillside, mirroring through the center of the elevation, the hillside declining below and the ridge line of the house, the roof ridge rising up on the exterior. And all of this glass facing north in Marfa and sheltered from the wind. And the floor plan layout of the house with the front porch and rear courtyard. But again, thinking about this thing as some kind of a performative vessel in the landscape, considering how it might perform in that way, and thinking about how these courtyard spaces might act. This is a project, this is a larger scale project. This is about 15,000 square foot commercial project in Winder, Georgia. It's three buildings that are now medical office space, mostly all leased to hospitals. It's still under construction. It's a very, very economical project, taking on the idea of a retail center or medical complex or, you know, strip center, and thinking about how you could create something new. The owner wanted to try something very, very exciting and make something that was going to perform very differently than all of the other buildings that are typically sort of a box in a sea of parking. And to use the massing of these elements to create these figures in the landscape that would create a particular scale to the exterior, but would create these a courtyard space between the buildings that would allow folks to walk around them and experience everything at a different scale. And again, trellises and planting for sun protection and ideas about thermal control, wanting to make these really delightful spaces. And how the proportion of these spaces are modulated in relation to the massing of the buildings and in relation to the interior spaces that are framed by these skylights. These are composite fiberglass skylights that are in each of the spaces. Again, it's a simple geometry in a way of two sections coming together, one oblique and one horizontal. And there are a couple different types of them, so they're slightly different scales, sizes. So the performative nature of buildings, something that I keep I keep going back to, and one of the points of research in form, and maybe going back to my thesis, was, you know, what can particular forms do better or worse than other forms? And in this case, working with a client who's a landscape architect in Puerto Rico to develop a house on the dunes in a kind of very ecologically sensitive setting, looking at wind and water flow over time, and thinking about how the walls of this particular house, rather than simply resisting wave action, for instance, and bouncing it off perpendicular, which causes a lot of destruction to objects and spaces, and in this case, foundation of the house around it. Having grown up by the beach in Malibu, I'd seen a lot of houses fall in the ocean after storms. I started looking into these ruled surface concrete walls as a way to deflect the water and actually help bury the house into the ground in a tidal surge. And so I did a number of 3D print models and took them to the beach and filmed them over time getting washed, you know, by the ocean, sand flows, and sort of looked at also ideas for all the things I care about view and light and spatial relationship to the natural setting, and created a series of studies of this final form, looking at how it would perform in different conditions, and maybe what traces of sand would be left in the surrounding landscape with wind or water, you know, going through the thing. It's kind of extreme. These are all photographs at the beach. And the idea of explicitly taking some type of technology and making it about sailing or the performance of sailing happens in this project. This is a classroom project in Pacific Palisades, California. That's the built interior. This was a research lab that's patterned after Stanford's design school at a middle school. And what they wanted to do is, in addition to this interior, which was all this maker space where they wanted to do 3D printing and they wanted to do robotics and filmmaking, they also wanted to create an outdoor space with a canopy. And the canopy is going to use, it's in the process of fabrication right now, but it's going to use, this is the outdoor space, it's going to use a sailing technology. This is a rendering of spinnaker poles that are used. These are actual spinnaker poles from a offshore big boat for racing. Using them, like all of the equipment and techniques here would be from sailboats. So this is a rigging system that would be used for spinnakers and other spars on a boat. So it has a roller furler, and it has all of these various leads. Here's some of the details. These are basically sailing details. And this is the project in fabrication right now. This is with the fabricator. These are the spinnaker poles collapsed. And this is the furler, and it's all on the frame. And I think for me, what's really exciting about this is it's going to be the first project I'm doing was actually using explicitly all of these sailing components in the building. And it becomes a didactic project for the students in the sense that they will get to operate the thing and participate in the physical activity of using the building. And they'll use it in a way that I think there have been a lot of studies talking about the relationship between the participation in the physical world, especially in such a digitally heavy age for kids in this generation, the idea that they would physically participate in their environment, I'm curious to see what impact that has on the pedagogical goals of the school and of the particular design and invention and creativity themes that the curriculum is based around. The idea of rigging like this is something I've explored academically. This was a pavilion I did with students at USC, which was a pavilion that was based on very simple conduit pipes wrapped with paper to damp the sounds and achieve particular pitches, and that students would walk through this installation and create these sounds. And another student project, again dealing with tension elements and in a way dealing with very low-tech, high-tech, was something that was digitally modeled and worked out, but physically built and physically woven. These were all strings that the students wove in overlapping colors and coated with resin to create what were essentially stress skin surfaces over simple 2x2 dimensional lumber. And it was extremely strong for what it was. And I think the effects, it was like a stained glass effect on the surface of this. The project that Andrew had mentioned, performative composites, saline architecture, came actually right on the heels of this. I'd done this project in the spring with the students, and at the same time, Greg Lynn was finishing the construction of his GF42 trimaran with Fred Karubla, and I'd been talking to Greg about it a bunch. Greg had another boat at the time, and I was racing on that, so we were talking sailing a lot. And I'd suggested this idea of doing something that dealt with contemporary sailing techniques and their use in architecture. It's something that Greg and a number of other folks have looked at in their work and wanted to put together an exhibition and symposium about this phenomenon. This is at North Sails, at the North Sails Loft, where you're sort of in a Mission Impossible bodysuit and, laying strips of strands of carbon down to build sails over a mold, where there's actually a mold that's milled and built to it so that the sails, when they're filled, will have an optimum shape that's been predetermined through a model. This is Greg's boat. It westerly, this may be at Chrysler. Is it Chrysler and Associates? This is the hull mold. Yeah, this is it, Chrysler and Associates with Bill Chrysler, who did all of the milling. Great guy. And the section, and I became super interested in how these different parts of the hull performed in different ways, so that it performed hydrodynamically. It performed in relation to windage. It protected folks in the cockpit from spray. The shape of the chine on the hull actually moves through at one point to become a standing position and a sitting position and a lying down position, so that there's this symbiotic relationship between the exterior form and the programmatic space and the interior. that I became fascinated with, in addition to all the mechanical layout of the deck layout for the rigging. This is the hull under construction. This is the analysis of the fluid dynamics of both the water and the wind on the boat. So all modeled ahead of time. This was the event, had a really wonderful lineup, just amazing folks showed up, folks who had worked on the design of the America's Cup boats, done the engineering for them, you know, folks who are in the forefront of composite manufacturing and engineering. And of course, we looked at the America's Cup boats, as Andrew had mentioned. These are really amazing. I think there are going to be some trials with the Louis Vuitton Cup, I think this summer in, I think in Chicago, you guys could drive up and check that out. The stresses that these are placed under are enormous, and it's amazing to look at a design problem where the problem is so extreme, where it becomes a matter of catastrophic failure if things are done incorrectly, and if things are done right and things are in balance, you know, this amazing performance in terms of speed and hydrodynamics. Buildings are a lower risk in this sort of way, but over time buildings perform in a way that's similar, just it's the scale of time is different. This is sort of measured in seconds or fractions of a second. The force on this particular element, which is the hydrofoil, which actually lifts the boat out of the water as it's moving forward through its shape, allows it to reduce the wetted surface and is what has made the great leaps forward in speed for these boats. Bill Chrysler loaned us one of these for the exhibition, which was great. So here it is being craned up to the gallery on the second floor at USC. Sort of a huge piece. It's our undergraduate chair, Hadrian Predock, watching. We had the sail from the boat that won the Pacific Cup, that San Francisco to Hawaii race, as well as the two guys who did it, a double-handed race. Two people were participated in the event. The foil, we had a chair that Greg Lynn had done with North Sails, with Bill Pearson from North Sails, who was there. In an exhibition on the parts, molds, and techniques by which Greg and Fred built this boat. Bill was on hand to present a number of things, including the hydrofoil and some of his projects with Chrysler and Associates. Bill's company is doing all the facades for the SF MoMA project with Snohetta. I'm sure you guys have seen photos of that. That's one of the panels. That's the project. Drawings from Greg's boat. And just looking at the way that the deck was laid out, so the kind of participation of people in the space, not just an object, but an object that relates spatially to humans, to our scale, how we occupy space and use it in a performative way, as a performance by people. The foil. And this is some of the stuff from the show. These are various molds for the rudder components, This is the acrylic for the hatch cover. These are 3D printed rudder bits. This is a section of one of the blades, which was laid up on this, one of the hydrofoil blades. Greg showing everyone how it was put together. Model of a prototype. Workshop with the students where Composites 1 came and they worked with students on doing all the composite layups, kind of basic techniques in fiberglass and carbon fiber. Students got to do it. There ended up being a bunch of press on this event, and I did a fellowship at the McDowell Colony up in New Hampshire right after, like a month after, and started looking at this issue, developing a studio syllabus for the project of sailing in architecture. So I was going back into my research on Le Corbusier from years ago and looking at the idea of the object type, the object type, looking at the cruise, like a cruise liner, the idea of an object that's refined over time. You know, that's Le Corbusier's main idea, right, with the temple and the car, is that the temple has evolved into some particular form over thousands of years to become what it is. The car, maybe only a few decades, but through competition or through iteration, that it becomes this object that has so much intelligence built into it. I became interested in the sailboat as the 21st version of that, you know, where he was interested in cruise ships and airplanes. And I thought maybe this idea of sustainability and relating to the environment, that sailboats actually use the environment rather than providing some type of engine or motor to sustain them in the environment. They're actually using the environment itself to make the thing function, make it work. And took this, so started a, taught a studio. It was, here's some of the students. It was a graduate studio, and Greg showed everybody his boat, which was fun. And students started trying to understand the relationship between form and program, and doing all of these various analyses that were wind and sun analyses to get these certain formal results. And the students then started looking at components and detail sections of pieces, composites, and started applying them to housing. So we started looking at emergency relief shelters, single-family houses, and multi-family housing as the basis for the work. Various analyses that are 3D printed on the sections, full-scale prototypes, and then composite layups to actually look at prototypes for the work as well. And this is Neil Smith from Composites One. He came back and was enormously helpful to us. And some of the student projects, emergency relief shelter. This was a single family house, and looking at ways that the services became part of the poche. I'm advising one of these students now in a research project looking at composite buildings and what opportunities there may be in section. Multifamily and aggregation. There was, turned out to be a bit of a metabolist strain that worked its way into the studio, which I was actually okay with. I was pretty excited about, and then saw some students really took that on. Again, these were various analyses that students did, looking at particular boat layouts, looking at deck layouts, actually looking at the scale of sectional relationships in boats, and trying to figure out how buildings might perform in similar ways spatially. This journal, Composites in Architecture, wrote quite a bit about the studio, and their editor attended the final review of the projects, and you can see this online, Composites in Architecture, as well as a number of ideas about composites and their use in architecture. And the studio was very exciting, well received. As a learning process, I think it was a chance to actually design a design process, because we had sailmakers and boat builders come into the studio and talk about what are your values when you're designing, how do you design, and cause the students to actually rethink a lot of assumptions about how or why they would design in a particular way. And for me, that was really the most exciting part about it. We did an exhibition of the student work. I'm the vice president of the LA Forum for Architecture and Urban Design, and we put on an exhibition of the work. Again, the emergency relief shelters. We looked at single-family houses. This one was strung from trees because it was so lightweight, and it was part of a planting and for urban forestry project. You could operate in tension in ways that you couldn't otherwise. Another emergency relief shelter, single-family house that was an inflatable composite skin that was hardened, which could also be aggregated. Maybe this is perhaps the most metabolist of the projects. Exhibition of the works in Santa Monica. When this was with the city of Santa Monica and the LA Forum. And we had a symposium and panel with Gail Borden and the city planner from the city of Santa Monica. This got picked up in the press too, this show, the exhibition and the whole concept. And I guess I wanted, in my own work, I maybe will show a couple more slides, but I wanted to say this is something I'm continuing to work on, but the idea of site as an overall project is something that, I've been looking at all these kind of high-tech systems for the last year and a half, 2 years, and I had the opportunity to go to China this last summer and start this project looking at the redevelopment of rural China, and started to think, well, how do you reconcile this stuff with like an agrarian culture that's bifurcated between urban density and kind of traditional systems and techniques of building. And this is maybe some of my latest work and least formed work, but I just wanted to leave you with a taste of that, doing a pavilion at on a winery in China. And again, maybe going back to this idea of site, maybe this has to do a little bit with my initial research in Chandigarh and thinking about what does it mean to do something different or to relate to a traditional culture in a way that's meaningful to the folks who live there. This is Dean Kinyal Ma, the Dean of USC, who owns this winery in Jade Valley. And he's done some really beautiful work kind of looking at this traditional masonry technique for making buildings in a traditional Chinese vernacular with modern sensibilities and techniques. And like touching, I like this slide because it was about like, you know, the kind of the touch and the tactile nature of this work. And they did a thing there where we went to these buildings and presented designs. We're looking at doing a series of pavilions in the landscape. And I'm thinking about these as some kind of, say, vessel in the landscape or an optical device for viewing in the landscape. These are little pavilions for napping. They're like day beds. You'd have them, it's for a, people would take them for a day when they go to the winery and nap and rest, and it's part of a larger cultural phenomenon of exploring the rural countryside, which is familiar to Americans and not as familiar to contemporary Chinese culture. But how, through some combination of digital and hand fabrication, can you get a particular result? And I'm dealing with a site right now in California in Hollister Ranch, which is an agricultural preserve, and looking at how to do two houses on a site which is just all about nature view, extreme 40-knot winds pretty regularly, and abundance of natural light and cows. So today, Andrew and I were walking around and saw some agricultural sheep, saw some sheep on campus. So I threw this slide in just because I thought it was fun to think about, again, like the winery or this, what do you do with these? This is an agricultural preserve, or how do you reconcile this with contemporary technology? And our sense of space. But the relationship between program and the site and the viewing and the optics, and ideally the things that I care about that make sailing work as an analogy and in many ways a provider of techniques and ideas for architecture, I think are present. And this is a ripe opportunity for that. So I will finish with that. Thanks, you guys. Thank you.
Have any questions for Geoffrey?
Yeah. Yeah.
And creating a design that's intrinsic to the garage so that you can't separate the two. And what I'm wondering is if you have any examples or any thoughts about architecture, specifically sailing architecture, and how we use it not just to create an object or to create an addition to an object, but recreate something that's existing.
Oh, I think that's the point exactly. I think you in a way you've almost answered your own question, because I think that's the answer there, and probably the result is something, if it's done well, that, you know, there may not be an example for, in the sense that you're going to take two well-known things, you're going to take a spa or take a parking garage or something, and combine them in ways that they aren't just spa, parking garage, okay, now they're next to each other. It's the whole, maybe the adage, the parts, some of the parts, you know, the somehow this composite thing should be greater than, right, those individual elements. And I think that the idea that you would bring in some of the other ideas from landscape that would probably inform where plants would grow best and how those plants would be able to provide certain environmental conditions and how those environmental conditions might be useful to someone in a spa, visually, environmentally, you know, from anything from climate control to oxygen quality in the air, whatever it is, that you would find those symbiotic relationships between those to create something that's entirely new and different, and ultimately make the parking garage a better thing and make the spa a better thing as the result of them being forced into some sort of confluence. Ms. Lewis. Yeah.
And I think you spoke very eloquently about the technological transformations that you were looking at, what the material research was. Certainly the sailing exhibition that brought a lot of those things together.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right.
But you actually didn't share with us what that was, and you didn't make that explicit.
Yeah.
And I was wondering if you would be generous enough to give it up for the audience. How does this? What are you interested in pursuing? Beyond a sense of space.
Yeah. Sure. Great question, by the way. I was nervous throughout the whole presentation. You're going to be judging my graphics, you know, for the. No, it's a great question. I would say that so each project had something, many things that I'd say that I was hoping to. Let me back up for one second. One thing that I don't anticipate my work to be, and what I don't aspire for it to be, would be sort of a one-time experience of space where you have an image, you're presented with an image of a particular object or a thing, and you're sort of stunned in the aesthetic bliss of that moment of experience, but then as you experience it over time, it doesn't really give you anything more. It's just, it is what it is, and when you see it at first. And so one of the things that I'm hoping to do is to reveal places over time. So the small addition for the attorneys in Malibu, one of the things that I wanted to do was, they have this hillside, which I didn't talk about much in section, that goes up very, very steep, and it goes upward. Problem is, most of the places in the house and on the site, you have no understanding of that. You don't look up. There's nothing that causes you to experience that. So one of the things, by doing the windows to the north, to the clerestory windows to the north, they're actually arranged so that when you look through them, and there were a couple slides I think that showed it. It's hard to see in the image the greenery. I mean, in reality, you see clearly, you actually see up the hill, and they're actually aligned with the slope of the hillside in a way that you wouldn't really pay attention to that otherwise in any other space in the house. Similarly, the house is based off all of these 45 degree angles and plan, and the way that this particular addition is chamfered, it aligns with some of those, actually it aligns with one of the walls that comes off the kitchen, so that you experience that you experience the patio space, which again, I didn't show any photograph of it, it's not completed, but the exterior courtyard space is designed to be a second room. And all of that happens because this particular set of optical relationships between where those walls are placed in there. And then on to sun, in that example, would be where the sun occurs and how it's registered in the space and how the patio then is changed from having a particular use in the afternoon where you want to shield it from the harshest light. It's designed in such a way that once the sun gets past about 11 or 12 o'clock, you cast the whole patio space into shade so it becomes this usable space back there in a way that it currently isn't quite. You're also looking at ways that in the interior of that house where there were three rooms that were totally disconnected suddenly become connected through a vestibule, and you also, by cutting away and creating the sectional difference, you actually see that they're on different levels. You never actually experience the fact that they're on different levels the way the house is set up. You only experience that the exterior hides that. The interior, you experience it in kind of an isolated cellular way where you're in one space or you're in the other. This way, actually, there's a section that cuts through there and places those in relationship so you can have more of the Knowlton school section experience. So that sort of thing, yeah. It's kind of a long answer. We could talk more.
A last question for Geoffrey.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, was it the salt?
Yeah, he was also doing some sand.
Okay, he was, yeah. Yeah. He's doing some great stuff, yeah.
I really like the fact that every time you kind of go into sort of a research direction, you pair that with a studio where there's a lot of hands-on learning and iteration, and I'm interested if you could, how you might speculate on an architecture and landscape studio that might build on that.
I should have come equipped with more landscape answers tonight. I'm not a landscape architect, so these are my observations as an outsider. It seems to me, from the architectural side at least, that there's two disconnects that I see a lot of times in studio. One is that students don't have a very strong appreciation for scale. I think that that's something that's probably a lifelong learning process. I mean, it is for me. I'm still learning about scale quite a bit. And I think that for students especially, it's difficult. So I think the idea of representing something and trying to understand what you're representing is very difficult. I think the other thing is knowing about making or thinking about how things might be made in the process of designing them, which is a corollary to that, I suppose. So I would think that in architecture, to understand some of these basic components of design and what we do as architecture, like scale or making, are absolutely essential to being able to make informed design decisions. And it's like being a painter and like knowing how to mix paint or something like that. It's the same thing in knowing how various paints perform. So I think in landscape, I would think that students who had some appreciation for the scale of spaces, or how to figure spaces, or how to understand the scale or relationship of of spaces through the material relationship to every bit of landscape material palette, from inorganic to organic, and plant qualities and performance, all of those things. I mean, I would think that students actually doing work or planting or building this stuff or growing something or actually seeing it occur over time, or understanding that the relationship of what they do to the space in its use, because I think this is what I'm pointing to, is scale of kind of use and performance over time, that if students had a way to learn the impact of that, not just as I'm going to do this design of this thing and it's a static thing and that's the board you're going to see, or that's a model you're going to see, and that's, it's going to do these things, but some way to test that, or to say, you know, is that really, does that really work? Is it doing the things you say it's going to do? And it's usually just our judgment as instructors to say, yes, I think that is going to work, or that's not going to work, or, but I wish there was a better way to teach students to have that critical capacity to make those decisions. So, yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
All right. Thanks, guys.